At Primitive, we use a tool called JavaParser to take Java code and turn it into a three-dimensional model that you can interact with in virtual reality. That'd be fun to do a walkthrough video of the JavaParser codebase in VR to show how all the different components work together to take Java code, parse it into an abstract syntax tree model, and then use a symbol solver to actually link elements of that tree together into an overall solution. The code for JavaParser itself is available on their GitHub page, which we'll link in the description below. Also, if you download our demo off of Steam or Viveport, you'll be able to do this walkthrough for yourself to understand all the different modules. Whether you're building a tool for an IDE or you just like to gain a better understanding of how Java works, I think this video will be very helpful to you to understand how a tool like JavaParser can actually take Java code and convert it into its building blocks and really understand it from the ground up. So let's get into the VR and take a look.
Here I see the JavaParser codebase, and there are many different modules. I'm just going to focus on two of them for this video. One is the JavaParser core, and then the other is the symbol solver core. JavaParser core is going to take Java code and then convert it into an abstract syntax tree by parsing the Java code. And the way I do that is I have a JavaParser, or I can call the static JavaParser, and it'll instantiate a JavaParser instance for me. We can look at the different methods for ingesting the code. One would be to feed an input stream. Another would be to feed a file. Another is to pass a path to a file. I can also pass a class loader, which would take .class files and then read their bytecode to parse the structure. And I can even take a string of code, which is actually how we do it at Primitive. We actually pass a string of Java code and then JavaParser could parse it for us. Now you notice that all of these return a compilation unit. A compilation unit is the top level element in the abstract syntax tree that we get when we parse the Java code. Inside of the compilation unit, we're going to see our package declaration, our imports, the types, this would be classes and enums, and a couple of other elements. And then what I can see here is that as I drill into the abstract syntax tree, I get deeper and deeper into the tree. So I have types, which would exist under the level of compilation unit. Inside of types, I'm going to have bodies. Inside of bodies, I'm going to have expressions and statements. I'm going to look at my types next. I have a class or interface. Inside of the class type, I'm going to have a body. I want to show one specifically. Let's look at just a method declaration. A method declaration is going to have a couple of different aspects to it that JavaParser is going to give me. So I have parameters, I have the exceptions that are thrown. If I just look at how a method is structured, you can see I have, let's say, an annotation. I have its access type, in this case public. I have the return type, in this case a string. I have the name of the method, and then I have the arguments. And all of this is going to give me a unique signature combined with the scope of where this code is defined. That would be the package. And then inside of that, I have my method body. Now, if I start parsing this, I'm going to see things like variable declarations. I'm going to see a conditional statement, and I'm also going to see invocations of other methods, which would be a call expression. And that's what I want to focus on next, because that's actually going to show how I can use symbol solver to make links between a call expression and then the declaration. So if I find method call expression here in my expressions, I see that all of these elements have the ability to get resolved, and that's where we're going to use symbol solver to actually link, in this case, a call expression back to its declaration. So let's look at how symbol solver does that. I see here I'm getting the symbol solver, and I'm asking it to resolve a declaration. So let's move over to symbol solver, and we'll see how all that's done. So symbol solver works with JavaParser core to take that abstract syntax tree and start linking elements of the tree to other elements. At the top level, I see I have my Java symbol solver. And at Primitive, we're actually doing our symbol resolution incrementally. So what we have to do is every time we get a new class definition, we have to inject the updated model into the compilation unit. So that's where you call this inject code. And then I asked my method call expression to resolve declaration. And so depending on what is invoking that, it could be a class or it could be an enum. Of course, we were calling it from a method call expression, so this knows that it's called from a method call expression. It's then going to try and ask the symbol solver to resolve the method. Ahead of time, I have set up several different type solvers, and let me explain what each one of these are. So the most basic level is we have a JavaParser type solver. What this does is it takes a path to a directory, and it reads inside of that directory to determine all the different Java files and then all of their different method signatures that exist in those Java files. And from that, I can actually link a call expression to its declaration. I might also want to pass a class loader, and a class loader is going to do the same thing effectively, but it's taking a list of .class files as opposed to .java files and then reading from their bytecode the method signatures. Similarly, I could take a jar and I could pass it to the jar type solver, and it's doing effectively the same thing as the class loader, but it's just in a compressed format in the form of a .jar. And then I think most cleverly, you can use this thing called a reflection type solver. And what this does is it resolves anything that is a Java standard. We're talking about java.lang.object or java.lang.string. It's actually going to reflect that signature against the Java virtual machine that this code is running on. And then the Java virtual machine is actually going to tell us what the resolution of that method is or what that type is. So if it's a java.lang.string, I'm going to reflect that against the JVM. It's going to give me back that resolution. And then that is actually necessary to be able to resolve other types that are user defined. Because let's say I've written a method that takes a string as an argument. I need to resolve what the word string means. So I actually reflect that into the JVM. It tells me what a string is. And then I can resolve the method signature that I've created. All of these type solvers are combined together in the combined type solver. And so we actually take a list of different type solvers, and I can use them all together to have an overall solution system for resolving types. So as a recap, what we've done is we've used the Java parser core code to create an abstract syntax tree, and then we've used the symbol solver core code to be able to link different elements in the abstract syntax tree together into an overall model. So Java parser is a very powerful tool. It's all open source. You can find all the code on their GitHub page. And here in Primitive, if you want to explore the Java parser code yourself, we have it as part of our static analysis code that we link here on our GitHub browser. You can see we have Java parser. We also have Antler 4, which I'm going to do another video on, because that is also a very cool tool that is not specific to any language. You can actually solve any kind of language abstract syntax tree using grammar files. And I'm excited to do a video about that as a follow-on to this video. So look for that soon.